So next up, we've got Oscar Bermeo, who is an amazing, amazing poet. We're so lucky. Am I pronouncing your name right? Yeah, okay, good. We're really, really lucky to have him tonight. His latest chapbook is To the Break of Dawn. He is like a local, you know, literary mainstay. He organizes a lot of really amazing readings, and he puts a lot of great stuff up on YouTube from like local poets. And he has a blog and everything. And, you know, he actually, for years now also, he's been building these incredibly ornate, you know, beautiful birdhouses for like the birds of prey of San Francisco. They're like these giant, like, over the regular city. They're like 100 feet up. You can barely see them from here. And like, they're like, they've got like gables and like gantries and chimneys and like, you know, all this like amazing furnishings, and they're like different neighborhoods for like hawks and ospreys and falcons and like, you know, and you know, the critics mocked Oscar Bermeo and said that this, you know, bird city would never be inhabited, but they were proved wrong. The birds have all started living there and commuting and like, you know, coming down to like kill your cat or local like bulls or whatever, and then going back up there. And you know, everything was awesome for a while until like bird gentrification set in, and like the ospreys were like trying to move in on like the falcon neighborhood and try to like drive up property values. And you know, and it just also, birds are like, especially birds of prey, are like major dicks when it comes to architectural criticism. There's a reason why they always make falcons wear those hoods. It's because otherwise they're gonna start like critiquing your drapes and shit. Like, just like, don't even let them see your decor, because otherwise it's just gonna get ugly, is the truth. And like, so like, Oscar Bermeo was forced to write more and more elaborate like brochures for like the bird of prey housing that he had built, which got like these giant tracts about like, that, you know, were more complicated than the actual buildings themselves, about like the advantages of the different buildings and the ways in which they embodied the noble spirit of the urban, you know, warrior that was the bird of prey. And and so these got more and more fancy and finally were being passed around and becoming like, you know, sought after literary masterpieces among humans. And he finally got like a Guggenheim grant for like $1 billion, which enabled him to build like a brain, you know, interface that allows him to like plug his brain into any bird he sees. So if you see a hawk like flying over the city, or an osprey, actually, the ospreys are good, and if you see an osprey flying over the city looking down at you intently and like possibly composing poetry about you, that's probably Oscar Bermeo, okay? So please welcome Oscar Bermeo.
It's all true. What's up, makeout room? How you feeling? That sounds like the I'll kiss you a little bit on the cheek room, not the makeout room. What's up, makeout room? How you feeling? A century of writing with an epigraph from Cypress Hill. How do you know where I'm at if you haven't been where I've been? Understand where I'm coming from. Be real. Coated, shaded, torn, mixed, warped, disrespected, accented, didactic. Scribe, bomber, lyric, eclectic, reflective. Reckless, recluse, misused, foolish, dervish. Strap hanger, traveler, gatherer, listener. Bitten, biter, appropriator. Mediator, contrived, denied, maligned, sullied, gully, gunner, target, shooter, blamed, framed, renamed, complaint, complicated, constrained, New Yorkian, instant, aesthetic, directed, brute, art space, disdained, reclaimed, Aloysia. Same old, Ramo, TDK, crazy, legs, rock, steady, rock, Kim, Chuck, D, Willie, Pietri, Algarin, Mikey, Amiri, Americano, BX, back streets, life lived, Puerto Rican, story stitching, Loco, Lalo, Papi, Mami, Comay, Gombay, Gome, Mierdas. Shit talkers, pop lockers, break, beat, repeat, play, rewind, remind. Scribble, scratch, smear, soil, toil, project, tenement, apartment. Thank you. So the purpose of the chapbook is to try to transport you from the modern dregs of commercial hip-hop, which all completely sounds the same to me, which is like why I wear the shirt. Because like whenever a 12-year-old tries to show me like their latest record, I'm like, nah, that shit is old and had. So, but if you type in P-Rock and T.O. Smooth into your Pandora radio station, you will get some really fly stuff up on your box. So, cause I know, because that's what I was listening to before I came here. P-Rock and T.L. Smooth's Caramel City. Who knows? Raise your hand. All right, that's cool. That's cool. That Lady Gaga shit will mess your minds up, people. All right, it's pushing away at your fucking brain. So we're going to bring it back to when P-Rock and T.L. Smooth were the hit. And I've never been a b-boy, but I always wanted to be a b-boy, and I thought I came really close one time when finally, after begging, I finally got a pair of suede Clyde Pumas, and this is my ode to those first b-boy sneakers. Ode to my Clyde Pumas. Before you came along, I was just another wannabe b-boy. Good for nothing, but a human music stand for the boombox. If I was lucky, maybe I'd be good enough to clear the crowd. As a senior b-boy from the crew would hook his arms under mine and spin me like a giant fan to shoo the other wannabe b-boys away as they began the ritual of dance. All that changed when you arrived, my new Clyde Pumas. Rich blue suede like an elegant Persian cat set to strike. Coiled, ready, but sweet and pristine at the same time. Alternating between growl and hum at your own will, with a turquoise racing stripe connecting arch to heel. The connection between ground and sky now defined, all held together with thick shoelaces wrapped around the toes like a safety net ready to catch me. With you on my feet, the transformation began, as regular jeans were no longer enough. Had to tie up my old leaves, bind them close to my calves so you could shine brighter. Complete the metamorphosis with a Georgetown starter jacket, gray and blue, like mercury trapped in sea ice. My moves could no longer be ignored by casual eyes. I could create tornado-level gusts with my windmills. Up rock, crisscross, hands cutting folds to shreds, pops crisper than cold lettuce, locks executed like bullets. No different than before, really, but you, my Clyde Pumas, became both my glamour and armor on the dance floor. Sharing a new shit with you, something I've just recently written. So before, in New York, the person who's responsible for most of the highways and the parks is a man by the name of Robert Moses. Anybody read the pop, right? You know what I'm talking about, right? Right? And definitely for an education, read the book, The Power Broker, the story of Robert Moses, because it will tell you how Moses did stuff like purposefully keep the pool in Harlem 5 degrees colder, because somebody had told him that blacks and Puerto Ricans didn't like swimming in cold water. And he just basically tore up New York. So this is this back to Robert Moses. It's called The Neighborhood and Tenant Association of Tremont Avenue, the Bronx, gather to erect a statue for Robert Moses. They all returned home from forced exile. Some from New Jersey, Far Rockaway, Long Island. Others cross the street from the nearby projects, congregate under the arch of the Cross Bronx Expressway. The dragon who, with asphalt scales, concrete wings, shadowproof glass eyes, and burnt tar smoldering from its manhole nostrils, slithered from the cave of the George Washington Bridge, and then coiled and stretched its six-lane body over the garden boxes, backyard swings, and open porches of the Bronx to suffocate the mosswood, grass fields, and sandlots beneath. But today, the Neighborhood and Tenant Association gather not to remember the beast, but its master, Robert Moses. The night before, in the shadows they've grown to know so well, they dug up the bones of Robert Moses and returned them to the site of his proudest moment. The bones placed in a discarded milk crate, the crate pedestaled on a forgotten tire, the tire adorned with a lost license plate, the back of the plate etched with bottle shards, the monument dedicated for all to see, erected for Robert Moses, usurper of farmlands, desecrator of rivers, enemy of clean air. May he finally serve the people of the Bronx as a bucket for bird droppings, leaking oil, and cigarette butts. In this service, may the willows of Williamsbridge, the oaks of Olinville, and the anonymous of Anywhere Avenue know Moses' penance will last as long as his highway. The next poem was written as part of a writing prompt, Luis Alberto Urrea, who I know is Charlie Jane's like good homie, right? Recall he was throwing out some writing prompts and he asked like, what do your hands remember? So this is what came out in response to that. Guzzle for hands that have never known work. Off to the corner store to get cereal for my brother. No cash with me, but some WIC checks to feed the family is what my hands remember. A week in the campo gets under my nails, leaves memories like dirt between my fingers. New impressions for these hands to remember. Want to create an encyclopedia of beats, breaks, and bass? Grab two turntables and forget yourself to find what your hands remember. In any fight, you best earn your respect. Win, lose, or cheat if you must, but always leave them a taste of your hands to remember. Ray J. Brown's first. Back by the fire hydrant, safe at second. Oh shit, game is on the line. Little O, best work the broom handle, eyes spalding, and let his hands remember. Pop and lock, a quick snap of the arms to force the body into staccato contractions. Eccentric angles for fingers and hands to remember. My father says, give and take, one washes the other. Compare and contrast. Come on, Oscar, put the work in your poetry. Make your hands remember. The last line is actually a very true story because my dad texts me and be bugging my ass all the time, and he actually like just gave me the end line to the poem because I had asked him like three revisions for it. And he was like, fuck it, here's the end line. For those of you who want to know, my father is a cab driver, not a poet, but you know, that's how that goes down. So one last poem, it's called Inventing the Remix. Walk the street whistling this, cutting and scratching, make that whistle sound, rock the bells. Cutting and scratching, bring that beat back, rock the bells, cue the crossfader. Bring that beat back, set it off on the left, cue the crossfader, it's time to get ill. Set it off on the left, the roof is on fire. It's time to get ill. Keep on moving. The roof is on fire. Let it burn. Keep on moving and release yourself. Let it burn, big beat blaster. Release yourself back to reality. Big beat blaster, make that whistle sound. Back to reality. Walk the streets whistling this. Thank you, everybody.